Kongrede üçüncü konuk konuşmacımız, ambalajda değişim ve yeni trendler konu başlığı ile EGMA Genel Müdürü Mr. Hans van Schaik.
Good afternoon, my name is Hans van Schaik. Thank you. Maybe then, just briefly, I'm very honored to be here and for the invitation, thank you very much. I will explain something about ECMA as the European folding carton industry, and we are very much into change at the moment, and I will explain this to you. What we are trying to do is have as much value for our members as possible. But we're not built in a few days. We are here already for 58 years. We were formed in 1960, so that's already quite a long time. In the famous year 2020, we will be 60 years old. And I think the successful formula of ECMA is to change continuously. So adapting continuously to the changing market demands and also the member proposition that is needed and what our members need. We are an association. So our members steer the association, and what they need is something we have to provide. We do not say that we will guarantee every time it will fit for 100%, but it's, at least it's our aim to be in the same pace as the industry, to know what's going around, and to hear exactly what's needed by the members, and that we are very close on the ball, I would call it. 50 years later, we're still there, and more healthier than ever. We, as I said, we have been changing continuously, and the last bigger change, I would say, a real milestone, was in the year 2012, when we adopted a new sort of form-up for ECMA. It used to be a federation of national associations in the different countries, and now we have formed, we still have the national associations, and we really need them, but we also have the direct memberships from different companies, and we are more focusing on a European level, I would say, as a pan-European umbrella. We have 49 leading converter companies, so in the folding carton, converting as member with various plants. Also companies here with direct membership from Turkey, but also multinationals, for instance, with a plant in Turkey. So we have a big spread all over Europe, I would say. I can say in every country of the EU or Europe. Maybe we can even say that. It's more than the 28 member states of the EU. We have 13 national associations, of which KASAT is the Turkish association, and we represent in total around 500 companies, a bit more even, I think, but there's a lot of consolidation going on in this market, a lot of mergers and acquisitions, and we represent, let's say, 50,000 employees in total in Europe. Of course, we also have our suppliers, as they are also here on the screen. Some names are also a member of ECMA. We've cherished them very much because they supply also the high level of technology and knowledge in the industry, so it's a working together industry. We have a good structure with committees and forums. We have well-attended congresses. Every year we have a congress. I will go into this a bit later in my presentation. And we have revitalized financials, and we were losing money until 2012, and now we have capital, and we're not losing on our events, basically. So that's also a good one. We have made a change that we are healthy again and with a good membership base. But this is something we want to move on. The world is changing rapidly at the moment, more rapid, I would say, than in years before. There's a lot of things changing, so we also have to look again for a new course and fine-tuning our course. And basically what we are is the state-of-the-art industry, I would say. All machinery is very capable of high speed, high quality. You need professional people to run it, but we need to improve even with this to be ready for the future. So now is not enough, we have to look forward. And also our excellent products, I think a lot is done by the printing. It's of course, it's also the design in the manufacturing, but the printing part of folding cartons is very important, and also how it stands out on shelves in supermarkets, for instance, and the high level of atmosphere it can bring over to a product. It's not just packaging for transportation or to keep it safe inside the box. It's also a big means of advertising, I would say. So printing is very, very important. And when you look at the excellence of our products, you can also say we have the award system. The previous speaker also is an award winner. We also have awards for different categories to single out which are the best packaging aspects, sustainability, how it looks in different categories, food, beverages. And we have an award system together with ProCarton. ECMA and ProCarton are doing this together. And ProCarton is more the promotional association in our business, and ECMA is more for the inside job behind the scenes, I would say. So more on the shop floor. So this is an important part of our industry. But we are looking at very big changes at the moment. Increased digitalization, former speaker also went into this issue. You see it in the overall supply chain. The different parts of the chain are communicating with each other on a digital scale. This also means that you have to transfer files, but also in a fast way. Everybody is waiting already, and I sent it 3 minutes ago to you. Did you already do something about it? So the whole pace is much faster. And also, the possibilities on a pack, on a carton, are very big, that you can see where the product that's packed is originated from, how it can communicate with the customer, things like that. Packaging is needed. We are, of course, I would call it the school of folding cartons. We are the best, but there is a lot of packaging, and everybody probably says they are the best. They are not, of course, it's folding cartons, but that's why I'm here. But packaging is needed. We're all in the same business, and we all have to protect food safety, for instance. And packaging is not litter, it's protecting a higher good. And also food, for instance, that it's preserved and things like that. So we need also the plastics, the glass, the metal and everything. So we're not bashing the other ones, we just say that we are the best, but we're all in the same industry. And of course, more and more what you see is the rise of the circular economy. Take good care of your raw materials, of your resources, and also how you get rid of it. And it's packaging after its life cycle is not litter, it's just a new raw material coming in again. So that is very important, also in the mind of people. And we are a part of let's say, normal life. A lot of the products are sold in different supermarkets and help you to go through your daily life. If you open a kitchen cabinet, you see all the products. So it's a part of daily life. So the whole communication with what's happening in the minds of people, of the consumers, is very, very important for us. So that's why we need to be connected and also see what trends there are and what's changing. This is what I said, of course, but we need to materialize this. We have, of course, a lot of wind in our sails because there's a lot going on about debates about plastics and the ocean and plastic things like that. This is the wind we have at the moment. It's probably temporary, but we need to materialize it. If we say we are the best, let's make money out of this and get a bigger part of the pie for our industry. Also, about attractiveness of future employees is one of the issues we have to tackle. For instance, it was mentioned before, I'm from Holland, and we have a very good schooling system, what I hear. Thank you very much. But on the other hand, I can say also that the practical technical schools in Holland are just like here. We used to have this system, but it's gone. So we are lacking technical people, and everybody's fishing in the same pond. And maybe people go to universities, but people on the shop floor with technical practice are not there anymore. So we have a big problem here. Learning education is also something for the skills for the people working already in the companies. In some countries, this is better than in others, I would say, the whole schooling system. What we would like to do is that all the good examples, all the best practices are brought to each other, and then we can use it and don't invent the wheel on this one. So that's one of the issues. Skilling of people was always an important issue, but we need to enhance on this at the moment. And also around corporate social responsibility, it's in the mind of people, but we also need to have a safe carton. That means a safe product, that it's not migrating the things or whatever, it's protecting the good and it's not causing any negative effects, but also a good working environment is very important. Also to get in new employees and youngsters. They cherish this more and more. And we need to know where our market is, what other markets are. We need more data and information to make good decisions. And we also need to tell the world what we are good at and what's our big benefit. And we need facts for this. That's basically what we're trying to... These are the challenges we see and we are trying to address at the moment. And this with collective help of ECMA. We have been building now a strategy plan and we are still building this. This is also a dynamic phase. It's under discussion at the moment. The first parts of this plan were introduced 3 weeks ago when we had our Congress in Riga, in Latvia. And we are working with this. So we are spreading this in groups and see what the responses are. But what we need is to provide our members with directions in this hectic world, I would say, increase the member value, and doing this with an effective ECMA in 2021. So let's say we have a 3-year scope, and what we want to do is exploit the infrastructure that's already there in a more effective way, basically. That's what we are doing. So we're not. This is not a revolutionary thing. It's more evolution that we are doing at the moment. We need to provide value for money for our members. We are an association, so everybody's in the same sort of guild. You can say we're in the same profession. You can be proud of it. But we also want our companies to earn money or to save money because of their membership. And what we also try to do is. We go more into the different levels that are in companies, the experts, the different people in design, in health and safety, all kinds of experts. We need to get them all aboard and work in our association, and not just CEOs meeting each other somewhere once a year or something like that. But we will keep this, of course, but also on different levels. More to the working floor too, that everybody benefits from the membership. So more people are benefiting and also ambassadors of our industry. And what we say is, of course, everybody is a competitor. Everybody is looking for his own piece of the pie, has his own unique selling points, but there is a common ground where you can all rely on, I would say. So don't invent the wheel on this one. And still competition, but on the basis of standards, and rules that are set by the members themselves, by the industry themselves, not by a government or whatever, but by the needs of the companies. ECMA is not a standalone. We need to work together, and we need all our partners. In ECMA, we have the converters, the national associations, and the suppliers. And suppliers, for instance, know exactly when companies are going for investments and things. They have a good visibility also in the future already. So they are also needed in formalizing our strategy, but we also need all our other business partners. And the problem with a lot of associations, I would say, even in paper and board, is that everybody's looking after his own association and proud of his own association and not working together enough, and there's lack of this. And this is something we need to do with our ProCarton, our sister association. They also have a new setup to be more fit for the future. And we need to be a right hand and a left hand of the industry and working together, basically, and divide the tasks. We also have CEPI, very well-known name, I would say, of the paper and board mills. We need them to tackle different issues, for instance, about fibers and growing trees and things like that. We can rely on them. We have CITPA. CITPA is the association for converters on based paper-based products in Belgium, in Brussels. It's on a European level. And we have the PPC, and it's the Paperboard Council, Packaging and Paperboard Council in the US, let's say our sister association in America. And America means the United States and means Canada. And altogether we have to work on this. And for ECMA, this also means that we use our bodies that we have, like the committees, the forums, and also the working groups that we are establishing at the moment. And the idea is that everything comes together within ECMA, or that we go to another branch and then work together in different areas, and that everybody is synchronized, basically, and in sync with each other, and not everybody with an own agenda. And it seems maybe like an open door, but I can tell you this is something that is really hard to achieve, because everybody has his own agenda and his own interests, and all to work together more in this industry is really a task, but I'm really positive that we can manage. Looking at this, this will be not be readable for you, I would say. The only thing I can say that you have an idea here is we already had our structure that was green, and what you see in orange are the things that we have established as new things. I can point out some things. Of course, the first part is that the members are the boss in the association. Then we have the executive committee with people coming from the converter side. We have only people from converter side in the executive committee. And we have the different committees, like the technical committee, the marketing committee, the association development committee for the national associations, and for the different membership programs. They are all also represented in the executive committee, so everything has a say in this whole system. And we have some pillars. Food safety is an important one. I will go into this later on. The communication part, which is extremely important, but also our different areas in the industry. We have a pharma forum for specialists on pharma. We have the SME forum that stands for small and medium-sized enterprises, or most of them family-owned companies. We have the suppliers forum, because we need them also. We are their customers, but they also bring the technology into our industry. We have the tobacco forum that has been fighting, I must say, or struggling with the whole new TPD2, the new tobacco products directive that was introduced in Europe. And we, something new that we are doing, an HR, so human resource and health and safety forum to address more effectively the issues we just mentioned around human capital, because this is really, really, really important, and we need to work on this in a more enhanced way, I would say. So we have different things. Just one thing also, maybe if you are in an association, one of the ideas we have at the moment with the working groups, this is new, is that we don't have the real committee meeting every time, four times a year, for instance, and in a long row of years, but that we have a specific topic that needs problem solving. Then we say to the members, we have this problem, who would like to contribute to this? And then we can fix this problem, let's say in 2 months, in 6 months, maybe a year, and then this working group is dissolved. So it's driven by the demand of the members, and we are close to the ball to deliver a solution for something, for challenges. So this is also one of the paths that we can say where we have a change, I would say, and more into the pace of nowadays. If you allow me, I will go into some hot topics that we are facing and which are of eminent importance for our industry. Let's start with food safety. Big proportion, I would say 50% of the turnover is generated in food. Europe, by the way, the turnover, you might say, is around 10 billion euro, I would say, pretty close to that figure on a yearly basis. And we have established some years ago the general manufacturing practice around food safety. And this is something that is becoming a standard. It's not there yet, we're still building on this. And but this is important to secure, to give good food safety measurements. These are the things that you want to avoid with your products. This is something, a stat that was produced by Foodwatch. I don't know if you know this, but this is an NGO looking at food safety, mainly in Germany, in France, and the Netherlands. And this is what you want to avoid. This is a stat of a few years ago, so probably where you see the red sore-looking faces, it already disappeared because things are moving fast, but this was what you don't want as an industry, and this is also what you don't want. Maybe people know about this person here, this is Professor Conny Groop from Switzerland. He is a sort of guru on food safety and migration. And we are talking about MOSH and MOA. I won't be too technical about this, but this is something we have to tackle and is already tackled, and we're still working on this. And so you don't want any bad publicity and problems with reputation for your brands. This is the worst thing that can happen. So we don't want to be in this area at all. So what we have is we have our food safety ECMA seal, which is based on different prerequisites, I would say, of what's already there. It's the Global Food Safety Initiative, which consists of BRC, IOP, IFS, FFSC, things like that. That's already, they are here, and then we can fall back on waste handling, auditing, risk assessments, and things like that. That's here. You see here a part that is something that we have in common also in our GMP, and that is about the process flow, about cleaning, about logistics and things like that, about traceability. That's something that we have adopted also in our GMP part. And then you have this part here. This is what's on top of it. So we have a sort of cherry on the cake, I would say, of the prerequisites that are already there and are the well-known systems. And what we do here is handling of the folding carton itself. For instance, how to treat glues, how to treat inks, and things like that. So very specific on folding cartons. So this is something on top of it, and we're really trying to sell this as our big advantage. If you have this ECMA seal, then you are really securing food safety as much as possible. But there's also one thing we also have to change or work on. To secure food safety, we also need barriers. And many of those barriers are polymers. They are from plastics. And we are in the carton industry, and we have a recycling system. So there's a problem here. We need more fully recyclable barriers that can be of plastics, it can be of varnishes and things like that. But there is a sort of paradox between what you're doing for the environment and what you're doing for food safety. It doesn't always exactly fit. So this is one of the challenges we have to tackle with each other in the industry. But in the end of the day, we are looking for food safety and good manufacturing with a checklist also, so it's manageable for companies. The checklist is also meant for people on the shop floor, on the working floor, that they understand what they have to do. And then we have this very good system, I would say. We have all the material available in 6 languages, and if there are countries who want also it in their language, this is absolutely possible. This is just about spreading the news that food safety is first with ECMA. An area of innovation, if I may come to this. What you have is technical opportunities and possibilities, and basically you can divide them in 2 parts. You have the active packaging, where something is happening, something is a moisturizing regulator, something is added to the, for instance, the fish, and then it stays fresh a bit longer, or things like that. That's something you can do with your packaging, but also the intelligent packaging. That's also very important. And this means that you can have all kinds of indicators. If something is still fresh or whatever, you can also use it in a data system that it's digitally available. And you have all kinds of communicating technologies where you can communicate with your customer, saying where the origin from the milk is from, or how many of certain things you still have in stock, things like that. So this is an important part of our industry at the moment, where we can do a lot more, and it's also based on cost, of course, if it's all possible, and also on the demands of the customers and also of the consumers. But I think we're just standing at the beginning of this phase where more and more is known what we are doing. It's basically also part of the statistical part, where you can let statistics work for you and make life easier. And we're not about IT and robots and things like that, that we are too digital. It's more that we are still human beings, and we need the IT stuff to work for us. And it's not a goal on itself. If you look, for instance, at pharma, this is a far end of the industry, I would say. Here you see, for instance, if I may give you some examples of what you see here. What you see here is, for instance, you will be reminded that you need to take your pill, for instance. You can also see that you have, if you don't have enough in stock here, you will get also a sign. It's easy to open, and you have all kinds of different product information on one box. So a lot of information is on this box. Also, when you look at this one, there's also a system that communicates with the need of the patient. The patient needs knows when he or she has to take his pills. Also, for instance, what I understand is that some medication has the biggest effect on a certain timing, maybe before eating or after eating, or if you are awake for 2 hours and things like that. So you can have better medical treatment just by giving the patient information with the PEC. And also, afterwards, you can get more data to, for instance, doctors or statistical medical institutions, and they can use the data to get better feedback on how medicines are working. So this is really a good example, I would say, of what is possible with packaging, and in pharma, a lot is already happening. Also, for instance, what you see here is a timer. And this is a little display here. It's of course also a matter of cost, and this is a high-end product. But you will see the more it's used, the more the cost goes down, the more you will see this in daily life. So this is what's happening in folding cartons at the moment. Good things about innovation, basically. But there are also, if you look at change, we also have something that's called plain packaging that's arising at the moment. And I don't want to be gloomy or whatever, but it's something that is happening. And if we're talking about change, this is one of the issues we have to tackle. I just mentioned the TPD2, Tobacco Products Directive 2, with all kinds of warnings on cigarette packs. I'm pretty sure that everybody, smoker or non-smoker, has seen them wherever, with the graphical health warnings. they are secured in shops and things like that. The EU, or let's say not more than the EU, it's also happening in Australia and in the UK, still EU, but it's something to get people from smoking, to make a pack as unattractive as possible and give as much health warnings as possible in the same time. That's basically the TPD2, and less space for branding. We are, of course, in the industry of complexity and knowledge and sophisticated packaging and things like that. And if you just have a plain pack, that's something that's against our nature. We are into complexity. Also, complexity is very important if you look at, for instance, cigarettes and anti-counterfeiting and things like that. You need complexity. That is not easy to produce such a pack. The more complex it is, the better it is. So basically, this is something important. And then we can spread our knowledge as industry. What you see now is, for instance, that packs are looking like this with dirty pictures. Nobody will like these things, to warn you. But the problem is also that they think these kind of products should not be branded. They should be as unattractive as possible, so a blank thing. But if you look at this, and this is also what's happening already in Brussels, but it's more than just Brussels at the moment, is that they say, well, this is cigarettes. This is the first phase. But we also have to look for liquor. We have to look for fatty foods. We have to look for confectionery, chocolates and candies and things like that. Everything that's bad for people and what they like. So this will come up. You see it here already on ale, health warning on it. It's more of a sort of example. I don't think it's really there, but some countries already have some things on liquor. But what you see here is, for instance, like the McDonald's box. It says Big Macs make big children. So this is very, very bad if you get this. But there is a sort of notion going around that we need also packaging to convey these messages at the moment. If you look here on this plain sheet with plain packaging, and this is about tobacco, everything in red are countries that already are going into plain packaging. So no branding and all kinds of warnings. That means Australia, where it started in December 2012, Ireland, but also France, Norway, Hungary, UK, New Zealand, so more the Anglo-Saxon countries. But if you look at the list above here, a lot of countries are thinking of introducing this. And here on the top is Turkey, and they have political commitment about plain packaging to introduce it. So it's happening everywhere. Also in Georgia here, in Thailand, Slovenia, Canada. So it's Malaysia, Kenya, Botswana. So it's all over the place, I would say. And this could be harmful for the industry if it starts with packaging of cigarettes, tobacco packaging, and then spreads to all the other parts where we are good at. So this is something to keep in mind, I would say. Also a part of change, maybe we can call it a negative change, but beware of this change. Now something more, less gloomy, I would say, where we have a very good story to tell, a very, very nice story. This is about sustainability. I think this is the well-known triangle how to do it. Avoid packaging or material, that's not our business, to be honest. Let's use material in a good, proper way and reduce it where possible. But we're also not for the landfill because we're losing their raw material. That's where we are good at. But if we go, for instance, at reuse, recycle and recover of materials, I think we are in the folding carton industry are already far in this area. And if you look at us, you see that, for instance, with the production, you see the raw materials coming in basically with 40% of renewable fibers, 46% of recycled inputs. So this is already quite good. You're using your raw materials in a proper way, and a lot is already also recycled. I can break this down. If you look at the feedstock, so the raw materials coming into the loop, you see that the renewable fiber here in orange is 40%, 46 is recycled, and then you see that you are using in a sophisticated manner your raw materials. If you compare this to plastics, then you see that 90% of plastics is coming from fossil feedstock and is after use, it's gone basically. So I'm not in the school and bashing plastics, but it's more that I would like to express here that we have a good system which is environmentally friendly. The recycling part, if you look at this one, you see 82.6% of recycling is done in folding cartons. I think most of the countries already have this. If you don't have the bin, then you have the system, for instance, I'm from Holland, we had it for the football clubs or for churches. They collect all the old paper and board waste, and then they can get money from it. So there's a well-known used system for it. And if you compare it to plastics also, you see that they are still working on this system of recovery of materials. And this is just in the child's shoes, I would say. And it's moving on, of course, and they need to. But this is also something where you need the mentality of people to start collecting all things. It's not rubbish. It's a part of a new raw material you can use. You can recover. So it's also about mentality, as is littering, basically also, which is also hovering above our head as a threat. You can throw away packaging, but the basic part is still that it's the mentality of people not disposing of it in the right and proper way and just throwing it away. And if you start with this, you already have gained a lot, I would say. Also, when we are looking at our renewability part, we have introduced, we have borrowed, I would say, from the US, the system called TICKET. And TICKET stands for trees into cartons, cartons into trees. Basically, the fundament of this system is that we are growing trees, we're not cutting down trees. Of course, we are harvesting, but because there is a demand for fibers, wood fibers, there is a demand to have forests and have them all growing. And we are growing more trees than that are cut down, basically. What is here is that we should make people aware that this is good, this system of growing trees and making some use of it. This is something that we are doing together with ProCarton, I mentioned, the promotional part of our industry. And they will go to the consumers and the end users with this scheme. But of course, the members of ECMA have to bring all the knowledge in to make this packaging. What we will do, we go again to all the schools, start with the young kids, because they are still open-minded and we have to educate them when they're still young, and then we can benefit from this later on, because everybody is consuming, all kinds of countries. I think also Turkey is booming in consumption. We have new groups that are consuming, so you need to do it in a proper way. and also with the recycling system next to it. So then you have less burden of new consumption, also in China or India or Africa, whatever. So we are trying to educate people, run a program with local schools. So in just in the smallest parts of countries, so on the smallest level that people are educated, and they can grow a tree. So they have a sort of a planting kit, and then they can plant a tree, and then you can have, as an industry, you can have a lot of promotion around it, of course. This is also one of the benefits we have. So good publications. And then we can tell we are the good guys, basically, as the industry. Everybody is taking care of this, but this is how we take this matches of being the good guys. So you can make your own planter and go to schools. And we have kits available, kits in with a T, for children to use. And you can also, as a company, can use them as a distributing center to send it all out. Also in different languages, and if there's need for more languages, that's possible. To tell that we are the good guys, that this is not about just sustainability, but this is for our whole industry, and everybody's competing with each other. If it's on students, if it's on workforce, if it's on who is getting the deal with a brand or a retailer, everybody's competing. So we have to tell our good story, and what we need to do is to be in contact with NGOs, schools, and universities. For instance, about Foodwatch, we were not hiding for Foodwatch. Last year, at the end of the year, we went to Foodwatch in Berlin and explained what we are doing about food safety, and we have won already half of the war, I would say. We are not the enemy anymore. They see us as a reliable partner with progress in this area. This is important. But also schools and universities. Schools are so locally divided that we can use them to bring the good news. And what we are trying to do is, based on facts, bring one story. You have facts and you have the real facts, I've learned some time ago, but we are really from the real facts, so not the funny stories, but real facts. And we need to distribute this one story via multiple voices, basically. So we have a workforce of 50,000 people. We call them the new ambassadors, and they can tell the story. And also, adding to the previous speaker, this is not plug and play or paste and copy for the whole world, which is produced here maybe in the UK with, or in the US with the ticket plant. You need to translate it in the language, but also into the culture, of course. So we need the national associations like CASAT here to bring it forward in the proper way. So we need also our national associations. So we have the pan-European part, and we have the national associations as distribution centers of the good news, basically. This is the idea we have, and this is something we are doing together as ECMA and ProCarton. And telling the good story is also about, this is the industry you want to work in. This is where you have a good job. There are printers here. Printers are, of course, in the graphical industry, are looking for a new course probably at the moment. Graphical printing is going down, so you need alternatives. Maybe they are looking also to go into packaging. That's certainly possible, of course. But if you go into packaging, you need special requirements to meet the customer's demands. This is a highly sophisticated industry, and not anything can happen. But because this is a highly sophisticated industry, it's also attractive to work in. If you don't have a job, or you're still at school and you want to go for a job, this is a prosperous industry, we think, where you can get a good career. And where we need to tell that people get good skills for the employees. Also in this part, every country is doing something about education, but what we need to do is that we share the best practices that are around. If you look, for instance, at the UK Association, BPIF Cartons, they have all kinds of forms of e-learning, where you have different parts of the industry, and then you can get with your tablet or your laptop, you can go into a certain program, and you can get you get all kinds of questions, and you can answer them, and then you are educated. Also, the company can see if you are on the right level and if you need more training, for instance. And people are sort of playing around and they are sort of gaming, I would say. And then they get education in the same time. So learning and playing together. this is one of the examples I would say that everybody can benefit from. And also we need to synchronize more the knowledge we have and bring everybody on the same level, because in every country I would say it's different. And also about this one is health and safety, also very important. We've seen studies of the youngsters. They're not into it for a big salary or things like that. Still important, but they need free time. They need a company that they can associate with. That's not something that they say, well, they're making money, but I don't like the product that they're producing and things like that. People think more around the product and if they feel good what they're doing. So this is also very important. So we need to get people in a healthy and safe environment. There's no competition in safety. This is also a part where we can share knowledge with each other and work on the most safe industry, because you are working with machinery and things like that. So there are risks, but you have to assess them. You have to address them in a proper way, and also to share the best practices together. And this is what this is my thinking of it. I think most of the machinery is quite similar. If it's in Turkey or in Austria or in Denmark, I think the machinery is pretty similar. So we can do something there together and build together a safety culture and basically also good reputation of our industry. Very important also investing in the young people coming in. And of course, there is a lot of things happening on a global front and how to address this as an association. We cannot make sure that the currency of the Turkish lira is getting better or whatever, or that a president in a certain country is taking decisions that are harmful for trade. The only thing we can do is provide directions and an horizon to our members. We do this in our annual congress. I think there you see something about just looking around over the fences and a bit more broader horizon. And also we will do this in seminars where we can tackle a certain topic. And that can be about fluctuations. Probably one of the next ones will be the Brexit. It's getting important now what will happen with the Brexit in any way, whatever it happens. But there will be a lot of bureaucratic problems. Companies are looking if they want to move to other countries. There's a lot going on, a lot of uncertainties, a lot of myths. And let's explore together what are the possibilities, what are the real threats, and talk about it and discuss it with each other. And basically these things are always that we have the possibility for people to together reflect on the developments. And that's why we use our congress and seminars. So basically we have our committees, our forums, our working groups, our seminars, and our congress. So for different levels of problems or challenges, we have different bodies to tackle it. I mentioned our congress three weeks ago, well attended. We had about the festive night where we also present the awards for the with the gala award, the excellence awards, and also young designers are there, also from Turkey. Very, very good designers, and we can see there, it's a very nice evening. We had it in Riga and Latvia, and next year it will be in Malta, so it's close by, and people who are member of CASAT or also people who are not member of CASAT are also welcome. Please come over and have an idea of what we are doing in Malta, the 19th and the 20th of September, and I can guarantee you we have a full working program with interesting speakers. And high attendance with both converters but also suppliers. So this is also for CEOs a good way to get connected with all kinds of peers in the industry, but also to see what's happening on technical sides. And we have a good social atmosphere also to discuss all together all developments and to meet each other. Everybody is fighting as competitor on the market basically, but these are the surroundings where people can meet in a neutral way and yeah, get acquainted with each other and see where they can benefit from each other. So basically what we're trying to do is, the theme is of course, is change, stories at first hand about change. We are trying to constantly be changing and adapting to the needs, to the demands. So that's basically what we are doing. And that also in our membership proposition, so we're listening as much as possible to what the members want, and we also need to be in the same pace, in the same atmosphere as our members, and then we can add value. If we know where their problems are, then we can have the solutions and work on it together. And basically we're saying this is the power of working together, and if we manage this, we can say we have the success of working together. And then we can make a bigger pie of the whole industry and make our members happy and have a good future for the companies and for the employees also. Because I think also the human capital part is very important in the industry. This is not a negative industry. This is an industry that shares, that values, appreciates the importance of the people that make it happen. It's a big, big team, I would say. This is my personal view looking at the industry. I'm not working in this industry, I'm working for the industry, but I think this is an industry with a good mentality, and you can be proud of this industry. So I hope in 2020 we can come to the fact that we are still of relevance and 60 years old. 60 years old is the new 40, I would say, if you would be a human. So you're not old, you're still dynamic and young, and this is basically what we are standing for as our change at the moment. And I thank you again very much for the hospitality and the opportunity to be able here to speak to you all. Thank you very much. If you have any questions or remarks, please ask me. And you see my number here. This is our office. We are based, by the way, in The Hague. Not in Brussels. We have a Brussels office, but our main office is in The Hague. You see our website. You can also see, if you are there, you can click on one of the links to the ProCarton website. And you see my personal email address. If you have anything, please send it to me and I'll address it. Thank you.
Mr. Hans van Schaken, aramızda olmasına vesile olan mütevelli heyet üyemiz ve kısa adı KASAT olan Karton Ambalaj Sanayicileri Derneği Yönetim Kurulu Başkanı Sayın Alican Duran'a teşekkür ediyoruz. Vakfımız ve kongre katılımcılarımız adına Mr. Hans van Schaken'a teşekkür etmek üzere BASİ Yönetim Kurulu Başkanı Sayın Saadettin Kaşakır'ı arz ediyorum.
Thank you very much.
Şimdi sizlere kongre sponsorlarımızdan Feza Cilt Bezi Sanayi Atilla Güney firmasının çay kahve ikramına davet ediyorum. Buyurun.